Hey yo, from the Kingdom of Ohio, you are listening to OCCULTURE, where we used to think Whitehead was just another reference for our teenage acne. I am your host, Ryan Peverly. Welcome to the show, thanks for hanging. We're gonna wax pretty philosophical this time around, because our guest is Peter Sjöstedt-H. Peter is an Anglo-Scandinavian philosopher of mind and a metaphysician who specializes in the thought of such philosophers as Alfred North Whitehead, Nietzsche, and Arthur Schopenhauer, with special regard as well to panpsychism and altered states of sentience. Peter received a bachelor's degree in philosophy and a master's degree in continental philosophy from the University of Warwick. He subsequently became a philosophy lecturer in London for 6 years, but is now working on his PhD at Exeter University, where he also teaches philosophy modules and writing skills. Peter's also the author of Noumenautics, a collection of essays which traverses the mindscape of metaphysics, nihilism, and psychedelic phenomenology, and that collection of essays will form the basis for our conversation here today. Peter's writing on neo-nihilism was also an inspiration behind the Marvel superhero Karnak, which oddly enough did not come up in conversation here, my apologies. Regardless, it is a fine chat, with some rather complex questions and some rather complex answers, but that's what we signed up for. So if this agrees with your intellectual palate, let's open our philosophical mind and cast our pod all over this reality canvas. Enjoy. All right, Peter Sjöstedt-H, thanks for being here, man.
It's a real pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Oh, no, the pleasure's all mine, believe me. Your last name is Swedish, or at least part of it is. So, curious about your upbringing. Were you raised in Sweden or the Scandinavian area?
It's complicated. So, I was actually born in Sweden, in southern Sweden, a county called Skåne, or Scania in English, which used to belong to Denmark until Sweden took it a few hundred years ago. So, southern Sweden I was born, but as a baby I moved to Cornwall, which is in southwest Britain, the most southwesterly tip near Land's End. And I was raised there mostly, but I spent a couple of years in Sweden in the 80s or 80s and 90s. And then I spent 10 years in London. And then about 6 years ago, I moved back to Cornwall. And now I'm based at Exeter and Devon, the adjoining county where I'm studying, teaching.
Yeah, and you know, the reason I asked that is because, well, one, I've never talked to anybody, I guess, who would have even lived in the Scandinavian part of the world. I was just curious about the lifestyle over there, because it seems a lot, I don't want to say better than it does here in America, but it just seems like they have a different approach to a lot of different things.
Yeah, I think it's quite interesting, me being binational, because I can compare Sweden to Britain, and, you know, some very interesting differences that I'm sort of outside of both as a result. So Sweden is a more affluent country. There's a higher quality of life there. But it's, compared to England, at least in my experience, it's more narrow-minded in the sense that eccentrics are not accepted as they are in Britain. You know, you've got the great English eccentric legacy here, and all sorts of thinking and ways of dressing and ways of speaking and writing are sort of, you know, in a way, celebrated here, whereas in Sweden not so much. It's you know, there's a very kind of constrained mode of thought. However, trains are on time, everything's clean, food's much better in Sweden, so it depends what where your values lie in life, I suppose. But I chose to settle in Britain because I prefer the, I suppose I'm quite an eccentric thinker, so that suits me better.
Definitely, yeah. And this is sort of a shallow question, but I'm curious about the accent then. If you were born in Sweden and you said your mother was Swedish.
Yeah.
Your father was British then, or what?
Yeah, my father's British, okay. And he was born in London. So he's a Londoner. So that's, I suppose, where I've got my accent mostly. But he met my mother in Spain and they both decided to move to Cornwall because it's a very beautiful place, very artistic, by the coast. It's almost like an island. I mean, it's almost literally an island just cut off by the River Tamar. So, yeah, but I suppose my accent really comes from my father, but also from university life. You sort of, when you teach students from around Britain and around the world, you have to sort of pronounce each word sort of staccato, you know?
Yeah.
So you don't have a sort of regional dialect because you'll alienate a lot of people. You have to be as clear as possible. So I suppose it's developed from that as well. So my accent is kind of my dad's, but my father, he mumbled a lot, and I try to avoid that as much as possible.
I've heard you speak on many other podcasts, and you're quite eloquent, quite well spoken. So it's coming through already. So tell me a little bit about how a young man growing up in Cornwall becomes a philosopher, you know? Like, at what point in your life did you look at yourself in the mirror and say, Peter, you're a philosopher?
Well, I still ask myself that question, really, because it's actually a philosophical question. What is a philosopher? You know, do you have to have an academic post? Do you have to have published, you know, so on? But what made me interested in philosophy? It's difficult, really. I mean, I suppose I was known as the little philosopher when I was a child, because I was always asking, you know, but why, you know? But I suppose lots of children do that. My father had a number of books on Eastern philosophy, which I became interested in as a teenager. And then I remember I was interested to study that at university, because in English schools, at least when I was at school, philosophy just wasn't a subject. It wasn't an option. So I didn't know anything about it except for these Eastern varieties that my father had. So I tried to study that. It was that or science. In school, I was sort of, I really enjoyed mostly science and art. But somehow I was more attracted to the broader questions, you know. So I wanted to do Eastern philosophy at university. They didn't really teach it anywhere. So I settled for Western philosophy. And then, you know, I was introduced to it because I had no idea what it was about at all. And then I suddenly, you know, became really interested in it. And that was 20 years ago now, I suppose. Yeah. And the interest remains.
So you mentioned science and art. Do those intersect anywhere with philosophy in your view?
I think in a way, philosophy is somewhere between science and art, or perhaps in between science, art and maths. Or perhaps between science, art, maths, and English, somewhere in the middle, because certainly, I mean, you know, science, the word scientist, I think, first was used in 1836. Before that, you know, you had natural philosophers. So science was a branch of philosophy, and I still see it that way, an empirical branch looking at nature. So you still have that, and science is very important in informing philosophy. But at the same time, philosophy can compare the different sciences, you know, biology, psychology, if you include that as a science, physics and so on. It's still needed there. And certainly Karl Popper's philosophy of science, you know, with falsificationism has had a dramatic effect upon science itself. And Waddington's philosophy from Whitehead has had massive impact on epigenetics, for example. So it certainly it takes from science and it gives to science. But what I suppose in the last few years I've realized more and more is that philosophy is an art form, you know. It's not, at its best at least, it's not simply there to inform you. It's not an information point, but rather it's an art form. It's a craft, and you have to be very creative to express yourself in a way that is both sort of very informative, but also enjoyable to read, entertaining, you know, and artistic. So when I think about a composition in a painting and the harmony of the colors, the same sort of principles I think apply to good philosophy essays or books. Or articles, it's the same element there. And I think style doesn't just add to what you're saying, it sort of allows your expression to unfold in a better way. So you inform more if you can use style. So that's where science and art come together to create philosophy, in my view.
Would you say a philosopher is also on some level, or maybe on all levels, a poet?
Again, there's a similarity. I think Nietzsche said, I can't remember his exact words, but he said something like, a philosopher has to get as close to poetry as possible without stepping over. So, yeah, I mean, the poet is the ultimate stylist. And I suppose one of the main purposes a poet has is to evoke feelings within a person. And I think a philosopher can, if a philosopher can evoke feelings to, in order to give more information to the reader, or the listener, then that's only a useful thing for his craft. But I wouldn't say it's the same thing, obviously, because I don't think a poet goes out to provide knowledge so much. Rather, a poet's there to evoke feelings that one perhaps already has had.
That's an interesting way to look at it. Yeah, I think I would agree with that. You know, I have a question here that I struggled to compose because I wasn't sure exactly how I wanted to ask it. So I simplified it, and it sort of relates to what we're talking about here. And now I don't even know if the question makes sense, but I'm going to ask it anyways.
All right.
What is creativity then, and how does it relate to philosophy?
Oh, wow, that's a big question. Well, there's a number of approaches, I suppose. I mean, one of the main philosophers I'm looking at the moment, Alfred North Whitehead, the main principle of the universe for him, his whole cosmology, above that of God even, is creativity. Likewise, really, for Henri Bergson, the French philosopher, both of them lived in the 20th century. So one way in which you can approach creativity with philosophy is to analyze it, and, you know, in terms of how it informs say, evolution, how it informs art and so on. But also, as I was sort of intimating just earlier, you can, I suppose, in philosophical writing, you can, in a way, not teach, but you can light a spark in students to be creative in their philosophical writing, something I've tried to teach at Exeter University. But it's such a deep question. I mean, really, as well, I suppose, yeah, I mean, it touches so many things. So it touches an old philosophical debate, that of the contrast between determinism and free will. Determinism is basically the view that there is no creativity, because once, in theory, once you know all the laws of nature and you know the positions and directions of all the particles of nature, then in theory, if you were a supercomputer, superintelligence, or a super demon, like Laplace's demon, you would be able to determine exactly how the universe would unfold. And if that were true, then there would be no creativity in nature whatsoever. But of course, that would also imply then that there could be no free will. In other words, that your own consciousness or the consciousness of other beings could not have any effect upon the world, the universe. But the problem with that is, as Karl Popper again said, that if consciousness had no power upon the world, it would not have evolved, let alone maintained itself. And not only in humans, but also in other organisms as well. So Popper says that the view that the mental has no power whatsoever, this is known in philosophy as epiphenomenalism, this is an anti-evolutionary theory. So there's this kind of paradox at the heart of the general scientific method between trying to decipher the laws of nature and being able thereby to sort of create technology and predict the future, and with understanding how consciousness evolved and why it evolved and whether it serves a purpose. I mean, most biologists think that, you know, obviously sentience or consciousness evolved so that we could, you know, see predators coming or seek prey or whatever. But the implications really on a deeper level, you know, if you step back then in terms of determinism, free will, which is all free will then is about real creativity in the world, means that you can't be a pure physicalist and an evolutionist at the same time. But the funny thing is that most evolutionists, of course, can generally consider themselves as sort of, maybe not determinists, but at least followers of the scientific method, whereby there are, you know, four known forces of nature. So this is why creativity, asking about the nature of creativity, is so complex, because it just immediately brings in all of these very, very tough dichotomies at the heart of philosophy, really.
Yeah, and, you know, the reason I asked that was because of Bergson's, I think you described it as the metaphysical domain of pure creativity, that, yeah, like, fundamental reality is this metaphysical creativity, and that, you know, things like psychedelics can help you, I guess, connect to it, or yeah, does that, sure, mean that creativity then is maybe some sort of, like, maybe that is consciousness, maybe that is, like, a field or a source that you can connect to in various ways?
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting speculation that with psychedelic consciousness, then creativity overflows, you know, as you might know. But there's pure creativity not linked to anything quite often you've ever seen before or experienced before in your life. It's very hard to account for this in terms of predictions. I mean, even understanding neuronal activity. I mean, there's just, you know, the science there is in its infancy, and it's been carried out now at Imperial College and Johns Hopkins University and so on, but people don't really understand it yet. Could there be this creative field that Bergson, for example, speaks about that one gets a pure access to in the psychedelic state? I mean, possibly, quite possibly. I mean, he writes about it when at the cusp of sleep, Bergson does, when you're no longer concerned with practical matters. So your mind is, as it were, let loose from practicality. And thus, if you haven't fallen asleep yet, so on the cusp of sleep, you suddenly see a pure flow of this creativity, which might be some metaphysical principle, as they say, behind physicality and behind mentality itself. I mean, if you look at Whitehead's, something I've conjectured before, if you look at Whitehead's philosophy, he believes that as well as the physical and mental, which really are the same thing, there's a third realm, as Frege says as well, and Russell and Santayana and others, Kurt Gödel even, which exists beyond space and time then. And it's, for Whitehead, a realm of pure possibilities, and it's infinite. And a number of these, what he calls eternal objects, eternal meaning timeless, they are used within our everyday lives, you know, the colors we see around us, for example, numbers, feelings, and so on. But the possibilities exist in this eternal realm, somewhat akin to Plato's realm of forms, and they have not been tapped. They are there perhaps to be tapped in future eras. Eras, Whitehead says, we can't even imagine. I mean, an era beyond, he says, even that of the electromagnetic age, you know, by which he means, you know, today we live in a sort of a society of electromagnetism, one of the four known forces of nature, you know, sort of light and infrared and ultraviolet and whatnot. And perhaps a future age will exist, which then uses other takes or makes ingress other eternal objects of this eternal realm. But this is very, very speculative metaphysics. And when you go there, you have to talk about epistemology, you know, which means theory of knowledge. How can we know these things to be real? And you quickly realize that of today's era, modern era, I'm talking of the last few 400 years or so, the method by which most people acquire truth is the empirical verification. And one has to look at how that is very limited for knowledge. For example, you can't empirically verify the past. You can't empirically verify the future. Mathematical truths are not deemed as such through empirical verification, nor are logical truths like modus ponens. So one has to get into the epistemology, realize the limitations of this sort of generally scientific method of verification, and only then can your mind be opened, or not only through that method, but that's one sort of academic method by which one can open one's mind to other possibilities. And I mean, through verification, as I wrote in an article that came out on Panpsychism, through verification, you can't even know that another person has consciousness. You can infer it, but you can't directly observe someone else's consciousness. So you realize that a lot of knowledge is based on inference, on analogy, on mathematics, on logic, and thus we have to seek other forms of understanding. And once you've got to that stage, which then alienates you from a lot of the academic community, at least the scientific community, then you can go into speculative metaphysics and talk about creativity as a principle in a timeless realm, which you can then link to more down to earth, as it were, or make perhaps the opposite experiences through psychedelics. This is why I've started to write about the interface between psychedelics and metaphysics, because it hasn't really been done yet. You know, I think it's partly because philosophy in the last 100 years has been very reductionist, very verificationist. It's sought to be a handmaiden into science. It's sort of getting out of that phase now and seeing itself as another route of many to knowledge. And I think that now that's happening concurrently with a new interest in psychedelics, psychedelic experience. So I think now is the time that metaphysics and psychedelics can really come together in interesting ways. And I haven't started. There are other people like Patrick Lundborg and, of course, William James, 100 years ago even, who have started this conversation. But I wrote a book a couple of years ago about psychedelics and philosophy, or psychedelics and metaphysics. And I think there's a lot more to come. And because it's all sort of uncharted territory, that's exactly what makes it very interesting.
Yeah, and let's stay on that psychedelic metaphysical thread for just a moment. You know, I'm curious as to where this movement began. Let's go back to the root of it. Where did it begin? I mean, well, did it begin with like Nietzsche? Did it begin with James?
Psychedelics and philosophy, you mean?
Yeah.
Arguably, it goes back to the ancient Greeks, because for 1,500 years in ancient Greece, there were the mystery festivals, the most famous of which were the Eleusinian mysteries, 13 miles or so from Athens, which happened once a year. For those who don't know about these mysteries, they were anyone could go who could speak Greek, and everyone was encouraged to go. All the great philosophers went, including Plato. And in these greater mysteries, there were the greater and the lesser mysteries, but in the main greater mysteries, participants had to go into this darkened chamber, they had to fast, and they had to take this potion called kaikion, which ostensibly consisted of barley, mint, and water, but it was a specific dosage, and after that, participants spoke of seeing the light, seeing great visions of the gods, and so on. So it's highly plausible that this kaikion drink was a psychedelic potion. In a book by Plato called On the Soul, or the Phaedo, he writes about the mysteries, and he writes about how he wants to be counted amongst the mystics, and he talks about a mystical experience where he saw great apparitions, saw this wonderful light, where he became accustomed to the afterlife, to death. And after saying this, after harping on about this great experience, which, like I say, was most probably a psychedelic experience. Albert Hofmann, for example, said that the barley consisted of ergot, this parasitic fungus, which is the basis of LSD. But anyway, after this experience, after saying that he saw his soul rise from his body and enter the sort of another realm of reality, he then goes on to use philosophical dialectic, in other words, dialogue, logic, to try to substantiate, you know, what his experiences in the mysteries were. That is, substance dualism, that the body and mind are separate, and his idea of the forms, which is this notion that the perfect goodness exists and the perfect form of beauty, a concept in a way, but not a concept because a concept is temporal, whereas these forms are atemporal. They are, again, eternal. They're outside of time. Nonetheless, I think a very good case can be made for psychedelics informing Plato. And Whitehead's famous for saying that Plato, all of Western philosophy consists of a series of footnotes to Plato. So if psychedelics influenced Plato's philosophy, then you can say that psychedelics ultimately were at the basis of Western philosophy as a whole, because, as I say, his philosophy is highly influential throughout the ages.
Plato's theory of forms is really the first philosophical concept that I gravitated towards as a younger man here, and I thought that was just really, it contextualized, you know, something that I couldn't, obviously, at the time when I came across it, and it just clicked with me. And you actually have a quote from Kant in the book. I just want to read it real quick. You said that, or I guess Kant said that, you know, we do not perceive objects as they actually exist. Rather, objects exist in the way they do because we humans automatically translate a given world into forms conforming to our mind's structures. So is that Kant then working off of Plato's theory?
It's a complex one, but I mean, he is inspired by Plato, certainly. But the difference is, I suppose, this, that a fundamental difference between Plato and Kant is that Kant split the reality into two. He said there's a phenomenal realm, which is the realm that we see around us, that we can experience in space and in time. And then there is the noumenal realm, which exists outside of that. So we project upon reality, as it were, forms of experience in order to experience. They're conditions of experience. So we, as it were, project space into reality. We project time, we project causality, and so on. But that means that if we are projecting these things upon reality, the question is, well, what is reality in itself? Well, Kant then says, well, we can't then assume that they are spatial or temporal or causal or colorful, whatever. So this sort of mysterious world X he calls noumena. Now, the question is, okay, well, if that noumenal realm is atemporal, then in that sense, it's similar to Plato's realm of forms, which are atemporal in that sense. However, the difference is that Plato thinks one can access these forms, as I say, through the mysteries, perhaps, through after death, and in other ways, through philosophy, ultimately, you know. And Kant thinks you cannot. So Kant is much more a pessimist than Plato ever was.
Yeah, and, you know, the way you were describing that, it made me think of, you know, I like to describe things in terms of art. I like art in all of its forms. I think it's the highest form of really anything, you know, magic or philosophy or whatever. Mm. Could we look at that then, like, maybe reality itself is just a canvas, and we are the artist, we are the creator, we tap into these forms, which are our artistic, you know, sort of toolbox, like archetypes or, you know.
Well, Kant, interestingly, yeah, Kant himself said that the creative genius is a mere conduit of the universe. So that creativity, which is somehow inherent in the in reality, somehow comes through the genius, and he's really the paintbrush rather than the painter. Schopenhauer, who was a successor of Kant's, he lived 1788 to 1860, he believed as well that art was the highest form of human experience, and specifically music. And he thought that art can express aspects of reality which philosophy or the intellect cannot express, language cannot express. And when relating to that to what we were saying about before with different types of knowledge, it seems that one gains perhaps insights into reality through art that one cannot in any other way acquire. And perhaps the same can be said about psychedelic experience as well, although maybe psychedelic experience is but a form of art. There's an art form. Another debate one can have.
Yeah, I do like where you're going with that thought too, man. Like, you know, art, you know, music or paintings, you know, these symbols, these notes that speak to us on a completely different level than, I guess, than we just can sort of drearily look at in our day-to-day lives. Mm. It's just these things that sort of penetrate that.
Yeah, I mean, when a movie uses a soundtrack, you know, music, sometimes it's criticized for that, for sort of trying to evoke the audience's feelings. But in a way, seeing the world using the emotional tone that music can bring is not a falsification of the world. It's just another way to view the world, because there's no real neutral way to look at the world anyway. You know, if you're, you know, listening to music as you're traveling in the train and it's some kind of, I don't know, very sublime, dark kind of classical piece or whatever, and you see the fields and the forests, you know, out of the window in this dark sense, it's not really seeing it in a wrong kind of way. You're sort of adding to reality. You're giving reality that emotional tone. And as you are suggesting, we are creators of our world anyway. I mean, we're not free creators. We've evolved to see the world in a certain way, which seems to be a way which is mostly useful for our survival and development, our evolutionary survival and development. So we see the colors we do, but we don't see ultraviolet or infrared, because that hasn't, in our evolutionary past, been useful to us, you know, but nonetheless it's out there. Bees see ultraviolet, so they can see patterns on flowers that we are blind to, for example. So yes, in a way we are creators of reality anyway. So if we add music to that reality, that just gives it another tone, as it were. And someone might retort that, well, yeah, but that's not, you know, part of physical nature, is it? That would be assuming that reality, as we see it, is only physical as well, which is a fallacy that Whitehead calls a fallacy of misplaced concreteness, you know. In other words, emotional tone is actually part of reality. It's not something that is purely exists from our brains, but is actually out there already. And of course, we project emotions onto reality, but also we take emotions from reality. And I suppose the great poets have been able to intuit those tones, emotional tones, and replicate them as well as possible in words, so to have the reader evoke them as well. But nobody sees reality, and I'm with Kant on this one, no one sees reality as it is. It's just a fragment. We only see a fragment in a very biased way of the world around us. So we are, yeah, artists, unwitting artists. And going a step further, from Kant to Schopenhauer, now to Nietzsche, Schopenhauer's successor in a way, Nietzsche's got this great line in The Joyous Science, or this great section where he says that man is both artist and artwork. In other words, one can create oneself as well. One shouldn't, Schopenhauer thought, you know, one is born with a character and that cannot be changed. Nietzsche argued that one should work on oneself as an artwork throughout life, you know, get to know one's weaknesses and then work on those, or hide those somehow and accentuate one's strengths. And this is ultimately a way to overcome oneself. This is almost cliche in Nietzsche circles now, to overcome oneself, to become, to make oneself, as it were, better, according to one's own perspective, at least. And for Nietzsche, that was perhaps also a way of looking at humanity as a species, you know, that he suggests in Zarathustra and other books here and there that mankind should overcome itself. In other words, we should perhaps aim at a new evolutionary stage of humanity, and that he relates to his notion of the Übermensch, the overman. And all of this is, I think, a lot of people say Nietzsche's a pessimist. Schopenhauer was a pessimist, but I think Nietzsche was an optimist, really. He you know, he famously said, God is dead. And the overman replaced that. And then that was his great dream cause, in a way, his great optimism for the future, the overman. And I think that's a cause one can give oneself to get outside of, to escape, as it were, existential angst, which is how a lot of people interpreted Nietzsche in the 20th century. That, you know, there's just nothing has inherent value. God is dead. There's no purpose to life. Shit, what do we do? We're lost here in this horrible abyss. But, you know, that's not actually how Nietzsche saw it. Nietzsche was, you know, this was for Nietzsche something known as passive nihilism. But he himself promoted active nihilism, which is this, that, okay, there are no established values, but there are nonetheless values that one can create for oneself. And these can give one an impetus in life.
Well, you're familiar with alchemy, right?
Not that familiar, no.
Okay.
I mean, I know what it is, but I'm not.
That's essentially, you know, the way that you were describing, you know, man as both art and artwork, and, you know, kind of perfecting or bettering the self. That's essentially what alchemy is about, you know. So
is that right?
You know, I'm sure you've heard the term philosopher's stone, right?
Sure.
Isn't it interesting how they describe that then? Philosopher's stone.
True, true, yeah. Well, yeah, it's not my field. I wouldn't like to, you tell me. I mean, as alchemy, do you think, you know, modern alchemists have been influenced by Nietzsche at all? Do you know of that?
I don't know of it personally, but the way that you were talking about him just now makes me think that, you know, perhaps a good alchemist was, yes. Maybe Nietzsche himself then was an alchemist. If he's really, you know, if he really saw the world that way, I mean, he is describing this more occulted science, I suppose, of transmuting a base level of consciousness into what he would call Superman or the Übermensch.
Yeah, quite possibly. I mean, there's a guy called, one of the first English commentators on Nietzsche was called A.R. Orage. And he was, I don't know if he would define himself as an alchemist, but he was part of the Aleister Crowley's crew, you know, Golden Dawn and whatever. And he used Nietzsche's philosophy certainly to push superconsciousness, higher forms of consciousness upon man. And I think Aleister Crowley himself was very much inspired by Nietzsche. But again, it's not really my field. It's a fascinating field. I am interested in it, but I just haven't had the chance yet to sort of properly look into it. But after you've said that, I certainly will now, yeah.
I really think with the way that you're talking about it and your just depth of philosophical knowledge here that you've been sharing so far, you may find some parallels between, you know, the sort of like Renaissance alchemy and this modern era of philosophical thought.
Well, I think, yeah, now you mention it, the Renaissance, yeah, I mean, I know Nietzsche doesn't speak about alchemy much, but he does talk about the peak man. Mankind peaked for Nietzsche during ancient Greece, Rome, and then the Renaissance. And the man who came closest to Nietzsche's ideal of the overman was a Renaissance man called Cesare Borgia, who was the cardinal and the son of Pope Alexander. Mm-hmm. Very corrupt, and you know the protagonist almost of Machiavelli's Prince. So Nietzsche certainly was very much he very much admired the men of the Renaissance. So yeah, who knows what alchemy in those times, what influence that might have had on him? Again, something I need to look into really.
For sure, man. Yeah. And you know, just to stay on Nietzsche for just a moment, you know, I think he had a quote, if I remember correctly. He said something around the idea that most people don't have the ability to evolve. Is that the quote?
Yeah. Well, I don't know if that's a direct quotation, but he certainly he didn't think that he didn't have a high regard for most people. I mean, he was an elitist for sure. Can't be denied. I mean, he wasn't a racist really, because he spoke about the great Japanese nobility, the great Arab nobility. Vikings, so on. But nonetheless, I think the person who first taught Nietzsche, a Danish Jewish guy called Brandes, he, in personal correspondence, he suggested to Nietzsche that Nietzsche's philosophy be known as aristocratic radicalism. And Nietzsche really liked that, yeah. So he didn't believe that most people for Nietzsche didn't have the ability to overcome themselves, and they were sort of concerned with petty matters. But that's not to say that humanity as a whole can't lift itself up nonetheless, I think. Well, at least that's the way I see it.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's sort of like regression to the mean, right? Like, you do have, I hate to say this because I think everybody's capable of being that creative force in their own lives, but you do have people that are sort of, you know, below average. These are probably the people that Nietzsche's talking about in terms of, you know, these are the people that don't have the ability to evolve or, like you said, are concerned with petty matters. I see that a lot in my day-to-day life, to be honest. And then you have the other people who, you know, like yourself, the people that put the work in, that give it thought, but then also, you know, take action on top of that. So
yeah, I mean, it's a hard one. It's an aspect of Nietzsche's philosophy that is not particularly conducive to today's general mode of thought, you know. And I've noticed over the last few years there's been, I mean, Nietzsche's always been seen as a, you know, very viable philosopher to study at university, certainly in philosophy and so on. And he's a very, very inspirational writer. So even people who haven't studied philosophy formally, they still get into him. But I have noticed a lot of attacks on him lately. And he has inspired, you know, the alt-right, I think, to a certain extent.
Yeah,
but he's also inspired, you know, the feminist movement very much so, you know, in terms of, you know, his whole notion of the will to power, his central tenet, and that everything aspires to power, albeit subconsciously, that, you know, when you have like tropes such as patriarchy or whatever, you know, you're talking about power structures there. And so he's very much influential through people like Foucault, the French philosopher of the 1960s, 70s. This way of looking at the world in terms of power structures is very much indebted to Nietzsche. And so he's inspired both the left and the right. But I think there's a danger now that he's being alienated. So it's probably best not to speak about his elitist views so much, if possible.
Well, I got excited there because my next question was, we're on the same creative wavelength here, obviously, but you mentioned he's been sort of lumped into like almost like a fascist category, it seems.
Yeah.
Why did that happen or when?
When? Well, he was... a lot of people, people who don't have just barely heard of Nietzsche say he was a Nazi. He wasn't, of course, because he died in 1900. But his sister, Elizabeth Fürster Nietzsche, she was very good friends with Hitler. Hitler even came to her funeral, and Hitler came to the Nietzsche archive. There's even a photograph of Nietzsche's bust next to Hitler. Nietzsche's sister also had, her husband was a real Germanic fascist, racist, you know, and he created a little Aryan town or village in South America called Germania, I believe. I saw a documentary about it a few years ago, and they're still blonde people in the middle of the, Bolivia or somewhere around there. I can't remember exactly where it was.
Yeah.
But anyway, so Nietzsche's sister was very much into the sort of whole Nazi movement, as was his brother-in-law. But he was very much against the anti-Semites of his time. And like I say, the man who made him famous, really, you know, more than anyone else, was a Jew called George Brandes, Danish Jew. And he was on great terms with him. But if you do read Nietzsche, like in Beyond Good and Evil, you know, it's not simply, although he says that, you know, anti-Semites should be jailed or something like this, there he also talks about, he also has some things to say about Jewish people which is not particularly flattering. And also, I mean, he symbolizes the whole master-slave dialectic as Judea against Rome, you know, the sort of this is when Christianity became, Judaism sort of transformed into Christianity to impose slave morality over Roman master morals, you see. So it's not a black and white case whether Nietzsche was anti-Semitic or not. But nonetheless, he didn't like the anti-Semitic loudmouths of his age, certainly not. So yeah, there's that aspect. And a lot of people then sort of just immediately conflate him with his sister and brother-in-law and then Hitler. He also inspired, though, the Duce, the Italian dictator. And he was the, you know, obviously a sort of creator, really, of political fascism. So there is that. But and then there were Nazi intellectuals such as Alfred Baumler, who funneled Nietzsche's thought into something compatible with Nazism. Heidegger as well wrote books on Nietzsche, and he was officially a part of the Nazi party. Ernst Jünger, Heidegger called Ernst Jünger the true continuer of Nietzsche. He didn't want to join the Nazi party, but he was a German soldier in the First and Second World Wars. So there is certainly a connection with Nietzsche and Nazism and fascism and generally elitism. But like I say, he's been very influential also on the left. So he's sort of the common cause of a lot of the political conflicts of the 20th century, strangely. Nietzsche was not interested in petty politics, but only grand politics, as he called it. In other words, you know, the evolution of the species or whatever. And, you know, he was against nationalism. He himself was without a statehood from his 20s, and he was against socialism. So national socialism doesn't suit him well, nor does socialism. Then obviously he sees socialism ultimately as a legacy of Christianity. So it's hard to pin him down. And the thing about Nietzsche is he wrote so much, and he can be interpreted in so many different ways that people will take what they need from him. And why not? You know, you certainly can. You don't have to accept Nietzsche whole. You can take aspects of his philosophy and reject other aspects. I mean, Nietzsche himself did. He's got three phases of thinking, you know, his early, mid and late periods. And for example, his later period rejects the kind of scientism of the mid period, you know, the mechanistic thought that was so prevalent then. And then I personally think that, and not only me, that he was developing a new sort of system, although he was ostensibly against systems, he was developing a new system of the will to power, which was somewhat of a return to Schopenhauer towards the end of his sane life, something which was never complete. I mean, he was going to call his next book The Will to Power, which he then changed to Revaluation of All Values, but he never completed it because he went in 1889. He lost his mind, and for 10 years he was in a vegetative state living with his sister and mother. But nonetheless, yeah, his own thought was constantly evolving. So you can quote Nietzsche easily out of context. I mean, he himself, if you look at the preface to his first book, The Birth of Tragedy, he's very, very critical of the assumptions he has within that book, the sort of Schopenhauerian, thus ultimately Christian, you know, unwitting Christian values there. So when you use Nietzsche, you know, one should ask, well, what Nietzsche are you using there? Because, you know, he's a different philosopher later in life than before.
I do like that evolution of thought in his own work. And I do think that is the mark of a good philosopher, is somebody who can look back on his own ideas and say, you know what, maybe I was wrong here, or maybe I should rethink this specific cosmology. And which brings me to a question that I wanted to ask you at the beginning of the chat, but our flow kind of dictated to postpone it here. But I think it's a good time to ask it now. I wanted to ask you about the current state of philosophy as a discipline, maybe. You know, it's not really a subject that gets much mainstream press these days for obvious reasons, but I wanted to look at it in terms of where philosophy stands in comparison to the last, you know, sort of major philosophical movement, that the beginning of that modern era, you know, like maybe the late 1800s there. Has there been any evolution of philosophical thought since then? Are we in a postmodern era, maybe?
Well, one area which has certainly developed a lot in the 20th century is logic. So until the 20th century, logic was that of Aristotle's, basically. And in the 20th century, there was a huge development from people like Whitehead and Russell, Frege and others, to develop much more complex and thus better systems of logic. And of course, ultimately, that really developed then into computer programming. So that's another example of where a branch of philosophy becomes its own tree, as it were. So really, I mean, you know, everything underlying the computers of today comes from that aspect of philosophy. That's one area where it has developed. That's a very dry area. And Bertrand Russell himself in 1948 came to say that logic was not philosophy. So there's that. Kurt Gödel, he was a great logician, and he was very good friends with Einstein. They, in Princeton, they used to hang around with each other every single day, went for walks every single day and spoke about Kant more than anyone else, funnily enough. But Kurt Gödel is famous for coming up with these two incompleteness theorems, which basically are theorems to prove that a mathematical system cannot prove itself to be true within itself, very basically. This has massive implications for artificial intelligence today. Roger Penrose, for example, has written about the implications of that. But anyway, he disappointed a whole generation of mathematicians who wanted to basically anchor mathematics in a definite reality, and that this wasn't possible then. But he himself was a Platonist. He believed in, I mean, he had some very odd beliefs, actually. He believed in beings in different dimensions, and but he was also a Platonist, and he said his belief in the eternal forms, mathematical eternal forms, led him into those theorems, which have been so influential upon today's thought. And his theorems themselves, he said, sort of fortified his belief in that realm of forms. And often you'll find mathematicians and logicians who believe in this third realm outside of the physical and outside of the mental. The term the third realm itself, Dritte Reiche, was coined by Frege, great German logician. So anyway, logic's developed, but Gödel, who I'm mentioning him because he became very inspired by the metaphysician Leibniz, who lived in the 17th century, and he claimed that philosophy or metaphysics had not developed since then. And I think there's something to be said about that generally, that in the 20th century, as I was sort of mentioning before, philosophy somehow took a step down, as it were. So science then, because of the Industrial Revolution, I think, and the extreme success of science with technology, philosophy saw itself as a handmaiden then to science. And okay, with logic, that certainly aided later, you know, computing. The main task of philosophy then was to sort of get rid of all the religious mumbo jumbo as they saw it, and just purify, clear the way for science to progress. And that was epitomized by a philosophy called logical positivism, above all else. But that came into massive problems when it came to the mind, because it just couldn't explain propositions such as he changed his mind. You know, that couldn't be verified except behaviorally. And then this kind of crazy behaviorist philosophy became prevalent, which is that there exists no conscious states at all, really. It's just a trick of language. So when you say he's happy, you're only really implying that he's smiling or laughing or jumping. This, unfortunately, was very influential because it allowed scientists, especially neuroscientists, to just work on, you know, the mechanisms of the brain without any understanding of how that related to mental states in themselves. In other words, in their sort of autonomous existence, or in their at least epistemically autonomous existence, I have to add. The question of how matter and mind relate then was seen as a pseudo question, even though people like Fiegel in the mid 20th century said, no, it's not a pseudo question. But nonetheless, it was seen that way. And thus metaphysics, which is very much about really the relationship of matter and mind, just didn't go anywhere. It was just sort of stalled. But then all of these contradictions in logical positivism, behaviorism and so on, identity theory, they came out and they were thus generally discarded. And about 30 years ago, analytic philosophy, I should also say this, in the 20th century, philosophy divided into continental philosophy and analytic philosophy. So continental philosophy concerns, you know, the great masters, Leibniz, Kant and so on. But also 20th century continental philosophy featured a lot of prominent French thinkers like Deleuze, Guattari, Derrida. And a lot of it, I think personally, was pretty, you know, very pretentious and didn't really, a lot of long words, long sentences, which didn't really amount to much at all. On the other side, you got analytic philosophy, which is mostly, you know, logical then. And that was, although it wasn't pretentious, it was really trivial and dull and boring and didn't really contribute much to knowledge. So what we've seen in the last few decades in philosophy, though, is an effacement of this dichotomy. So they're sort of coming together. And there's, I mean, in analytic, there's something now called analytic metaphysics, something I taught next to a couple of years ago, which is analytic philosophers taking metaphysical questions seriously once more. And they've gone into very strange places, like talking about the reality of all possible worlds. You know, it's a very common thing in analytic metaphysics. And it's become very, yeah, very, very, very odd. But I think now, especially with, in the 90s, I think philosophy and science kind of agreed upon the fact that, okay, actually, consciousness does exist after all, and we should take it seriously. And since then, because of something called the hard problem of consciousness, which is simply the question as to how mind and matter relate, also known as the explanatory gap, they've admitted now, I think most academics now will not deny, there are still some, but most academics, scientists and philosophers at least, will not deny that consciousness is real. And thus, the question as to their relationship to each other and also to the wider world becomes prevalent. And thus, we are seeing a return to more radical theories of metaphysics from the past. So, for example, I'm looking at panpsychism, the view that very basic forms of consciousness, or what I call sentience, inherent in every aspect of matter, these are becoming again considered in respectable academic journals and so on. So philosophy's, as it were, come out of hibernation. And I think it's now offering new, at least, you know, much more interesting speculations about reality.
Okay, so there are about six different avenues of conversation that, as you were talking, I was like, oh yes, let's go down this one. And then you said something else, and I was like, okay, no, let's go down that one.
Okay, sorry.
So, no, it's totally fine. I'm trying to figure out which one to go down now. You mentioned sentience. This is a concept that, does it get confused with consciousness? Are these two disparate things?
Well, it really depends on how a person defines them, and they're defined in many different ways. I think a lot of problems occur because of the conflation between, let's say, complex human consciousness, you know, all your senses, your inner senses, your emotions, your memories, and so on, are being the same as, let's say, the awareness of a lobster, right? They're going to be two very different things. And so in my PhD, one chapter is devoted to analyzing what we mean by sentience. Now, by sentience, which etymologically comes from the verb to feel, I mean the overall umbrella term which incorporates all forms of mind. So that could be, at the highest level, human consciousness, which is very focused, for example, or perhaps another high form would be then psychedelic phenomenology, to very basic forms such as basic hunger or basic fear or something like that. And you can analyze sentience into many different forms. So you can talk about the sensations, you can talk about concepts, you can talk about reasoning, you can talk about what Bergson calls the rhythm of duration, like how fast we perceive reality. So perhaps flies see reality much faster than we do, or they would see us in slow motion, for example. There's no real, interestingly, there seems to be no objective speed of time. that we experience a minute in a human way, that minute could be experienced as, you know, an hour by another creature, and probably is, or longer still. And there's also something in modern philosophy, the distinction between access consciousness and phenomenal consciousness. So access consciousness is when you're fully conscious, as we would say, of something. So let's say you're driving your car and you're very conscious. You haven't been on that road in that city before. You're very conscious of all the traffic lights and the cars behind you and so on. And that's access consciousness. Whereas phenomenal consciousness is when you're perhaps driving along your hometown road back home. And you don't actually have to be consciously aware of what you're doing. You're sort of on autopilot as a way. But you're still conscious, you know. You still, if you reflect upon it, you can remember just passing a traffic light or whatever, you know. So there are so many varieties of sentience that one has to tease out before one can really speak about what one means about the relationship between matter and mind. So, and that involves, you know, that is an academic enterprise. So, yeah, so there's a massive difference then between sentience, which is just all of these different types, and consciousness, which at least I would say is a rare phenomenon, which is only achieved in complex animals such as ourselves, perhaps in, you know, dolphins and chimps and crows as well and whatever. But it's rare. So consciousness certainly is not sentience. It's much higher than that. You can think of it as a hierarchy almost. And on top of consciousness, a self-consciousness. Some people confuse that as well. So when you're thinking about your own thinking, then you're self-conscious when you're thinking about yourself. And that, again, is a much higher form of it. But there's certainly a whole multiplicity of states of mind to be analyzed. And there's the science of that is called phenomenology.
So what's the difference then between mind and brain?
Well, that's that's a very, very complex question. You know, sometimes people use them as synonyms, but I think that should absolutely be avoided, even if one is a psychoneural identity theorist, which is to say someone who believes that the mind is the brain. What is the difference? Well, number one, mind can exist without a brain, so therefore they can't be the same thing. For example, an octopus has sentience, has a mind, even though it hasn't got a human brain. You know, 2/3 of an octopus's brain is in its arms. Okay, it's a brain, but it's completely alien to what we understand by brain. I also think, being a panpsychist then, that basic forms of mind, basic forms of sentience, not consciousness, but sentience, exist in plants and in amoeba cells and in mycelia and beyond that even. So I don't think that a brain is necessary to have a mind, but I think a human brain is necessary for human consciousness, just like an orchestra is necessary for a symphony. But an orchestra is not necessary for a sound, just as a brain is not necessary for sentience. So that, and there are very good reasons to believe that. And that's part of the article I just published called Panpsychism. And then there are other reasons as well. So the way we describe the brain, we use very different descriptive properties for the brain as compared to the mind. So if I describe, let's say, a neuron, I would talk about, you know, the soma, the main body of it, the dendrites, the axons that come out of it. I talk about the proteins that are transmitted between synapses and the impulses, ionic impulses that pass through the dendrites, axons, and so on, all of which I can describe in spatio-temporal terms. You know, I can talk about the size of a neuron. I can talk about the size of a protein even, and the form of that protein or that chemical, that neurotransmitter, whatever it may be. But these are all spatially describable. But when I talk about mental states, I, for the most, cannot use spatial descriptions. So if I were to speak about curiosity or pain, I couldn't say my curiosity is like 3 millimeters long. Or my enjoyment was 2 meters wide, you know, by 1 meter. It just wouldn't make sense. You cannot describe many mental events in spatial terms. Perhaps an exception is visuals, which you can say, like, if you imagine a square, you can talk about it in terms of relative space. You know, it's got 4 sides and they're all of equal length. So there is overlap. The interesting thing, for example, is that if you say that your imagination of a square is spatially describable and that's identical to moving pattern of the brain that's correlated to it, that also has a spatial description, of course. You know, the neuron's a very complex one, the neural activity. the brain activity, I should say, because it involves more than neurons. Of course, those two spatial descriptions are not identical. So you can't say that they are therefore spatially identical and thus the same thing. And another famous reason in philosophy why you should avoid what is known as what was common in the 1950s, something called psychoneural identity theory, which is simply that the mind is a brain, is this. Hilary Putnam and Fodor spoke about it especially. They said, if we think that hunger, let's take a mental state such as hunger, and let's say that someone's hungry, you put them in a brain scan and we see that certain brain patternation is activated, right? And then we say, well, hunger is that brain patternation then. The problem with that, of course, is that that would then mean that other species who didn't then have human brains couldn't feel hunger. Like, and Hilary Putnam uses the example of an octopus. He says, you know, to say that hunger is simply this particular pattern, this particular neural pattern, is then to say that an octopus can't feel hunger, which seems very implausible. So you have to therefore acknowledge the fact that hunger can be multiply realized. In other words, it can be realized by different types of brain, right? So like an octopus brain, a human brain, a bird brain, whatever. Unless we're to say that only humans can feel hunger, which seems completely implausible. So therefore, a mental state can't be identical to a particular brain state. It has to be something different. And where does that lead us? Well, it led them to functionalism, but that then led into other problems itself, and that's why it's really an open question still. But a lot of people simply think, yeah, mind and brain, same thing. Well, no, that just runs into too many paradoxes to be true.
Yeah, and that's why I asked you, because I fall into that paradox, obviously, for many years, and then in recent years, I've come to learn that they are two distinct things, and then your book Noumenautics definitely illuminated that further for me. So,
well, yeah, this is the interesting thing about. I mean, this has been known in philosophy for the last half century or more, but it doesn't really trickle down into the problem with another problem with philosophy is that it just is very insular, and you get philosophers speaking to other philosophers and writing journal articles like as reposts to other journal articles, and it just doesn't get into mainstream thinking at all. And then so like most people just assume that mind is brain, whatever, Sometimes linguistically, Swedish doesn't distinguish between brain and mind, really, so it's the same word. So, of course, that can lead to certain belief systems. This absolutely is an open question, and one should be very open-minded about it, and certainly not dogmatic, not at this stage. I mean, even neuroscience, cognitive science is at a very early age now, let alone the sort of cognitive neuroscience devoted to psychedelic sentience, which is so extreme. We're really in an infancy. So for anyone to say anything dogmatically is just a sign that they don't know what they're speaking about. Of course, one can put forward one's own arguments and speculations, and that's as far as it goes.
Well, that's why I brought up alchemy earlier, to be honest, was because, and you articulated that much better than I could just now. I don't know anything about how philosophers relate to other philosophers or even to other disciplines, but like you just described it, it's very sort of cut off, I guess, from other modes of thought or practice even.
No, absolutely. And there's a new thing in universities in Britain now called impact. So before, to get tenure, to get work in the university, you would have to have published in several journals and so on. But now another criterion for that, for getting a job, is impact. How much your work has impacted public discussion, or whatever, the public's or society in some way. And a lot of academics don't like that because they think they'll be sort of having to speak to the masses and dumb down their work. But at the same time, I think generally speaking, think it's a good thing because there's so many interesting facets which really haven't been communicated yet to the public at large. And also, when it is communicated to the public at large, other specialists in other subjects, as alchemy, as you say, or whatever, physics or biology or history or geography, they might suddenly see connections there with what they're doing, which could then lead to new modes of thought. And of course, if a subject does stay insular, then there's less likelihood of new ways of thinking. In fact, in many ways, for life to evolve, you need a liquid or a gaseous environment so that different molecules interact with each other. And thus we get evolution that way. And it's the same, I think, in academia.
Yeah. And, let's talk about the way that you think about this, because you describe yourself as a panpsychist. You're doing a PhD on panpsychism. Could you reiterate for us what that actually is? And then why you think it solves this hard problem of consciousness?
Well, panpsychism, what it means, comes from, it was coined by a Renaissance philosopher, in fact, called Patrizzi, a Neoplatonist. It comes from pan, it's ancient Greek for all, and psyche means the soul or the mind, so all mind. Every aspect of actuality, that is physicality, has an element of mind within it. So from human to hawk, you know, as I was a honeybee to tree, I think this is a line from my article, I remember now. Bacteria to mycelia to a molecule and the subatomic below these. So a molecule will have an element of sentience. And from a certain variety of panpsychism, Whitehead's pan-experientialist variety, there's no distinction really between the organic and inorganic. So you can't say it just, you know, sentience only pertains to the organic, because this is just a sort of false division that we've created. You know, molecules are organisms for Whitehead, because they perceive, they react to their environment, they remember things and so on. So, yeah, that's what panpsychism is. I was brought there personally, funnily enough, through Nietzsche. So in my early 20s, I became a, you know, very much a admirer of Nietzsche's work. And I especially looked then, in, as I've mentioned, into his will to power theory. And the will to power, he writes, is a pathos that underlies all force. This was the system he was creating. And then after that, I actually went back to Schopenhauer and looked at his will to survive. And the will for Schopenhauer is something that underlies all of physicality. And we know it in ourselves as basic desire, you know, drive, hunger, and so on, lust. And it is the intrinsic element of all matter. We feel it in ourselves, but it's, by analogy, it's there in everything. Bergson takes it a bit further, Whitehead even further. And his whole metaphysics is called the philosophy of organism. And there are a number of reasons to believe in it. One of the main reasons is anti-emergentism. So if you don't believe in panpsychism, and let's ignore for the moment other options such as idealism and dualism, if you've rejected those as well. If you don't believe in panpsychism, then you believe that at some point in the past, sentience emerged out of physicality, or sentience emerged out of non-sentience, or mind emerged out of something that wasn't mindful. This is, of course, something that would be a huge, huge jump in the nature of the universe, in the movement of evolution. Even the smallest touch of sentience, which is a perspective and a certain feeling, something comes into the universe which can no longer be described spatiotemporally, which has suddenly filters the universe to its own speed from its own viewpoint. I mean, this is something so radical that if you believe it, you have to have the burden of proof is on you to show that this happened. And this, of course, hasn't been shown at all. It's simply assumed. And generally speaking, emergentism, which is since the 1970s really the main philosophy of mind now, which is that the mind, just like, let's say, water emerges out of H2O molecules. So this sort of analogy is that mind then emerges out of the brain activity, right? But of course, water emerging from H2O molecules is not so amazing, because they're both spatially describable. In fact, they're just different descriptions at different sizes. Okay, water has got different properties to molecules, but nonetheless, it's all structurally, you know, spatio-temporally describable. But sentience isn't. It's something completely different. So emergentism, you can easily say that mind emerges from brain, but what does that actually mean? Does it mean that brain causes the mind? If the brain caused the mind, that would be a power or a force or a type of causation that is unknown to science. It's not a scientific view. There's no law of nature which describes the creation of mind from non-mind. It's just a speculation. Also, the problem with emergentism is that it can't, although it's tried, it cannot account for mental causation. In other words, that your desire or your ambition or your beliefs or your working things out have any effect upon the world. It just cannot account for that, because everything ultimately must be decided at the neuronal level. So emergentism, it reaches so many paradoxes, as did behaviorism, logical positivism, and so on in the past, that if one rejects it, which I think is the sensible thing to do, really, if one rejects it, then one realizes that mind never emerged out of matter. It couldn't have. It can't emerge out of matter, because of all these paradoxes of emergentism. Therefore, it must always have been there. And the evolution you get is an evolution in the degree of sentience, the complexity of it, just as you get an evolution in the complexity of matter through the ages. It's an emergence of degree rather than an emergence of kind. So when you see the inherent problems within the sort of the dominant viewpoint today, it leads, that one argument at least, as to why it leads to panpsychism. It's just much more parsimonious, smooth, logical to believe that sentience in basic forms was there all along. But then, of course, as we've said before, you have to differentiate different types of mind, sentience, you know. So we're not saying that atoms have any kind of consciousness as humans do, you know, far from it. Quite, you know, just as we wouldn't say an atom is like a human body. I mean, it's very, very distinct. There is overlap, but it's a very distinct thing. That's one reason why I believe in panpsychism. I mean, that's only a very brief overview of it as well. And that's one of a number of arguments. And of course, you know, panpsychism is an ancient belief. You know, the official first Greek philosopher Thales, he believed it. Heraclitus, you see Plato and Aristotle are sympathetic to forms of it. Like Plato talks about, as does Aristotle, the basic sentience of a plant. The Neoplatonists write about it. It became very prevalent again in the Renaissance, this view. And in the last few decades, it's becoming popular once again with people like Thomas Nagel, William Seeger, David Ray Griffin, Whitehead, of course, in the 20th century, I should have said. Bertrand Russell himself, the great logician, was sympathetic to it, or at least a form of it. In fact, the most popular academic form of panpsychism today is called Russellian monism, after Bertrand Russell. Then you have Galen Strawson, David Chalmers even, who coined the phrase, the hard problem of consciousness. He's very sympathetic to it. Philip Goff, Sam Coleman, a lot of analytic philosophers now are looking seriously into this ancient doctrine and creating modern forms of it. My own contribution here is sort of probably taking parts of Whitehead, taking parts of Nietzsche, Schopenhauer, Bergson perhaps, and fusing it into another variety, which I think is probably the best. But of course, I would think that. Yeah. But anyway, that's what panpsychism is, and that's where it comes from, and that's one reason at least why I believe it to be true.
So I've heard a couple criticisms of panpsychism, that it doesn't quite solve consciousness, maybe, that it's maybe too related to materialism, trying to keep that alive. I don't know what to make of that myself, but what do you make of those sorts of criticisms?
It's very interesting when I hear that people call it materialism or a form of materialism, because other people call it a form of idealism, you know, and other people still call it a form of dualism. It's been accused of being, you know, what it's not. And I personally see it as a fourth column, you know, so you get materialism, dualism, idealism, and then panpsychism is like a fourth theory of mind. Why is that? Because materialism doesn't really allow for the mental realm as something autonomous. Dualism, where mind and matter are distinct substances, can't account for interaction, for example. Idealism, I've got problems with idealism now because of something called representationalism, that we don't perceive the world as it is, but only as a sort of mirror, you know, as I was saying, Kant does in his transcendental idealism. I think Whitehead's criticism of that is very good. So in other words, Whitehead thinks, you know, we do directly perceive reality as it is, though we filter it. So panpsychism, or modern variants, I see as not as physicalism, because physicalism would not allow for the sentience of molecules. I mean, physicalism in most varieties only allows for sentience as that associated with brains. So I can't possibly see how panpsychism really can be seen as a physicalism unless you, as Galen Strawson does, as a matter of fact, unless you radically redefine what you mean by physicalism. But then if you do that, you suffer, you know, death by a thousand qualifications. You redefine something too much and it doesn't mean the same thing as it originally meant, and then you can't communicate. So I reject that completely.
Well, can I jump in here? Well, I was going to say, what about something like animism then? You know, this idea that everything, even what we would call inanimate objects, have some sort of, I guess, spiritual essence to them.
Yeah, so it's interesting the difference between panpsychism and animism. So animism was coined as a derogatory name by Tyler in the 19th century for like primitive cultures' belief that rivers and winds and mountains had a soul, you know, some kind of spirit, as you say. And I suppose the difference is this, that one of the central questions of modern panpsychism is how do you define a unit, you know? So you would call, let's say, an amoeba cell a unit of subjectivity, but you would not call, let's say, a sofa or a couch a unit of subjectivity. You would call it an aggregate, you know? In other words, like just a collection of many smaller sentiences. But within an organism, there's a unified whole again. So how do you define unified subjectivities? That's a very complex question. And you can bring in notions such as autopoiesis, which means a kind of self-systematic structure, something that heals and reproduces to a certain extent. This is a very complex question that people are working on. Arthur Koestler calls them holons. Leibniz calls them monads. Whitehead calls them actual entities or even organisms and societies even. So that's one way of overcoming that remark. You know, you have to be very careful with regard to how you define units of subjectivity. And that's something that hasn't been fully worked out yet in a satisfactory way, I think.
So, you know, this conversation of animism and then also of spirit, it makes me think of magic. I don't know if you know anything about magic. What do you make of magic?
I'd just like to add one thing I should have said. When you talk about units, holons of subjectivity, the difference between that and animism is this, that, you know, like a panpsychist wouldn't say a river had a spirit, because that includes a dualism, really, that there's the river and the river has something separate to it called the spirit of that river, as it were, although they're associated. And a river is not a self-systematic unit, really. So anyway, that's one thing. And panpsychism comes from a sort of philosophical angle, whereas animism perhaps comes from a more intuitive source. Not to say that's a wrong source, but anyway, that seems to be a difference. Okay, coming back to the question about magic. A famous Scottish philosopher called David Hume presented something called the problem of induction, which is this. It doesn't matter how many times you see something happen. That doesn't mean it always will happen like that. You know, it doesn't matter how many times you see the sun rise. It doesn't actually mean that tomorrow the sun must rise. What happens generally in science is we see regularities such as the sun rising or a certain chemical interacting with another chemical or certain speeds of light, for example, well, the speed of light being constant. And then from those, that limited, no matter how large the observed number is, that from that limited number of instantiations, we create a universal law, like a constant of nature. And then we think that's a law of nature. And of course, we don't know that because we can't see the future. And also, we've only seen a small fragment of time with regard to these instances. So, for example, the speed of light might fluctuate over millions of years. If we just measure it now for the last 200 years, we would see the same speed. But maybe in a million years' time, the speed of light will be different. So it would be logically wrong to say for certain that we know what the laws of nature are. We can't know that. And like I say, there is no known law of nature saying how mind can emerge from non-mind, upward causation as it's known. And then also there is no known law of nature, known in philosophy as transordinal nomology, for downward causation. How, like, for example, the mental can have an effect upon the physical, or how the mental can affect in any way the mental again, like one thought to the next. So there are many things that we know to be true, in other words, the connection of the mental and the physical, for example, but we don't know the relationship, we don't know the law of nature that connects them. There might be other causes and forces at play of which at the moment we're completely oblivious. And I think, you know, if you look at the history of science, we're constantly evolving our notion of the laws of nature. I suppose you can call it a law of nature because laws themselves change, you know, in legal system, so fair enough. I think one should always avoid the term constant of nature. That's too dogmatic. But anyway, our notion of the laws of nature are always evolving. We're gaining knowledge all the time, scientifically, logically, and so on, mathematically. So one could never say that a certain occult force, occult meaning unknown simply, can't exist because it doesn't fit into the known laws of nature, because we know that the known laws of nature are insufficient. So my personal relation to suggestions of paranormal forces, magic, and so on is simply to keep an open mind. But I haven't had time to really indulge myself in investigating these things because there's just so much more I need to sort of look at with these sort of philosophy of mind logical questions. But, you know, I hope to. And so my, you know, I think one should always maintain an open mind. But at the same time, not believe anything anyone says, because anyone can say anything.
Yeah, that's true. So have you heard of Jack Parsons?
No.
All right. He was a rocket scientist, actually. He was also a practicing occultist, and he ran with Crowley and his circle that we referenced earlier. I'm thinking of him because, one, he did practice magic, And he also had an interesting quote about positivism, which you mentioned several minutes ago in an unrelated question. So I just want to read this quote to you. If you have any comment on it, that's fine. I don't really have a question. I just wanted to share it with you because it came up in conversation. But Parsons was a prolific writer. But he said that any system of intellectual thought, whether it be science, logic, religion, or philosophy, is based on certain fundamental ideas or axioms which are assumed but which cannot be proven. This is the grave of all positivism. Magic, by contrast, was not so much a system, in Parsons' view then, as a method of navigating the polytheistic terrain, a method that anticipates the pluralism, relativism, probabilism, and pragmatism that have come to characterize so many contemporary spiritual practices and new religious movements. So I don't know if I have a question on that. I just thought it was an interesting quote that ties into the theme of our conversation.
Yeah. I mean, certainly, yeah, there are logical axioms like the law of non-contradiction and so on that form the basis of science, and likewise in mathematics and whatnot. Science certainly has got generally physicalist mechanist base. And that's why how verificationism ultimately founded, because the verification principle, which is simply that proposition is meaningful if it can either be, if it's either true by definition or if it can be verified by experience, at least in principle, that principle itself is not a tautology, is not true by definition, and it's not verifiable in principle. So the whole thing imploded. And that's just the sign of a, you know, inconsistent philosophy. But however, Schopenhauer famously said that philosophy is unlike all other subjects in that it takes absolutely nothing as assumed, as true, and everything to it is equally mysterious and strange. And so I would say that, you know, good philosophy at least does not have these assumptions. Schopenhauer, incidentally, was quite interested in magic, you know, to a certain extent, you know, sort of he spoke about hypnotism when it was becoming prevalent. I mean, I'm talking about the 19th century here, as mesmerism, I think he called it, as a sort of magic that he was actually, you know, quite sympathetic to before, you know, I think most people don't consider hypnotism magic anymore, but it was originally. Another thing I was going to say related to that quotation is, you know, a lot of the mechanism of today's general worldview paradigm is based on Newtonian mechanics. But of course, as you probably know, Newton himself was heavily into the occult. And interestingly, relating this to panpsychism as well, Newton said that there are obviously forces in reality of mentality. You know, the mental has a force. We see it in our own lives, or at least we think we do. And so we can't say that mentality is not a fundamental force of reality. Maybe everything is alive. He writes that in The Optics. That's the panpsychist view. You know, you'll often find that the great thinkers were, you know, always open-minded about these things, and usually what happens is the followers become very dogmatic and turn it into like a cult, you know, be that neo-Darwinism, you know, Newtonianism or whatever. And again, when you look at the history of science, you see that it's constantly progressing. I mean, the stuff in quantum physics today would be seen as crazier than the alchemy of you know, the Renaissance. I mean, things like the facts, you know, that the spin of a particle here will immediately change the spin of a particle on the other side of the moon if those two particles have been in contact before. You know, that's just an immediately, you know, not over time. That kind of stuff, or that a particle will assume a particle form if it's observed and a waveform if it's not. That kind of stuff in modern physics is beyond the weirdness of magic in many ways. And I know the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics, I believe its motto is shut up and calculate. In other words, you can use these weird quantum physics oddities in creating technology and predicting the future, but the question as to what that really implies is not, you know, a remit of the physicist. But nonetheless, they're very fascinating. And I suppose it's a remit more of the philosopher, you know, philosophy of physics. But the ultimate point of all this is to say this, that all of these occult forces that one can speak about, you know, one should certainly keep an open mind for, because in the future they might be fully accepted. I mean, look at another example. Neo-Darwinism became prevalent in the 20th century, and Lamarckism, which is the view that your environment and the way you act can affect your offspring. And that was completely seen as heresy, scientific heresy. But with Waddington, inspired by Whitehead, we now have the science of epigenetics, which accepts and has, you know, pretty much proven that your environment and the way you behave has an effect on the expression of the genes of one's offspring and grandchildren and so on. So you should never take anything dogmatically. So I'm open-minded to these things, but at the same time, I won't say that they're true until I've looked into them properly.
Sure, sure. Like any good philosopher would, obviously.
Yeah, so, exactly. You know, you always have to be wary of wishful thinking. But you know, the interesting thing is wishful thinking works both ways. So I think a lot of mechanistic scientists are wishful thinkers, because if you believe that, then you've got the world explained, and you know that when you die, that's it. There's nothing, and that brings a certain comfort to people. You know, you don't want to go to hell, perhaps, you know? And or you don't want to think that the incubus that you're experiencing at night sometimes could be in any way real. You know, you'd say it's a sort of, you know, some brain problem, you know, and that of course induces some kind of, you know, comfort. So yeah, you have to be wary of wishful thinking, but at the same time realize it works for everyone.
So my last question for you then, you know, we were talking about creativity to start the conversation, and it would seem to me that the goal of any philosopher would be to create their own philosophy. I mean, it's nice to study and debate all these other ideas from other philosophers, but wouldn't the aim of philosophy ultimately be to create your own, or are we all pulling from the same creative source, so there really isn't any new philosophical ground to cover? I'm curious what you think of this question here.
Yeah, well, Newton himself said one should stand on the shoulder of giants. And of course, I think all philosophers obviously are influenced by predecessors. I mean, Nietzsche was with Schopenhauer was Kant, you know, and so on, Kant with Leibniz and so on and so forth. But yeah, ultimately, I suppose that, I mean, I think if you think to yourself, I must create my own philosophy, then you're probably going to come up with things which might not be true, because it's not the truth that you're aiming for, but rather your own status probably. But at the same time, if you think that certain things haven't been said or have been said in the wrong way or certain things are missing and you can contribute to that, then of course that is the way to create something new. Personally then, yeah, I mean, I think my own view is that I would like to create novelty through combination, which is not pure novelty then, but at least combine the thoughts of Whitehead, Schopenhauer, Nietzsche to create some kind of power, pan-experientialism, or something like this, and also combine that with insights gained from psychedelic phenomenology, which hardly any philosophers have touched upon. So I think, yeah, by combining different elements, you can create something new, but it's very difficult to create something new in philosophy because it's been going for so many thousands of years. You know, like Whitehead said, all of Western philosophy is but footnotes to Plato, and that's pretty much true. Often you think you've come up with a new idea, and then a few months later you read that it was written 2,500 years ago in ancient Greece. Very frequently does that happen to me, unfortunately, you know. So one can strive to creativity, but it is difficult.
Yeah, and that also reminds me of the old quote, good artists borrow, great artists steal. So I imagine the same is true for philosophers.
Well, that reminds me of a quotation from Schopenhauer, which is, talent hits a target no one else can reach. Genius hits a target no one else can see. And that, I suppose, is the main distinction.
Absolutely, man. Well, Peter, hey, thanks so much for hanging out for as long as you did here today. Please do tell people where they can find your work if they're interested.
Well, my website's philosopher.eu, www.philosopher.eu. My book, Noumenautics, can be found on psychedelicpress.co.uk, also on Amazon. I've got a newsletter out, which you can find on my website. I'm a Twitter account, Peter Sjöstedt-H. I've got a big Facebook philosophy page called Ontologistics, where I sort of usually quote interesting lines that I come across in my readings. I'm reading every day. I'll be in Prague in June for Beyond Psychedelics conference, probably, definitely. And I've just discovered I'm speaking about Humphrey Davy and psychedelic phenomenology at the Penzance Literary Festival in early July. So Humphrey Davy, there's a statue of Humphrey Davy in my local town of Penzance in southwest of Britain here. He's a great chemist, but he was one of the first psychonauts. You know, he experimented with nitrous oxide and laughing gas in 1800, and it led to him to a kind of idealist philosophical viewpoint where he thought all of reality was but ideas. So I'll be speaking about this great Penzance man in Penzance and linking that to psychedelic philosophy. So that's where you can find me in real life. Otherwise, best place is probably Facebook or Twitter.
Fantastic, man. Well, this has been a great conversation. Like I said, I do appreciate your time, and hope to have you back sometime soon, man.
Yeah, of course. Just let me know. I've really enjoyed this talk because you've asked me questions I've never, some perhaps not even thought about before. So you sort of got me a few times there. But as a result, yeah, I really enjoyed it. So thanks a lot.
That is my blossoming philosophical, I don't know what word to put there, but yeah, that's, well, thanks. I'll just say thank you. Yeah. So,
okay. All right. Well, thank you.
And that was Peter Sjöstedt-H. My thanks again to him. His book of essays, Noumenautics, is available now from Psychedelic Press. Link in the show notes if you're interested. You know, I left a lot of questions on the table here because Peter's book, as you may expect, is jam-packed with philosophical awesomeness. It's dense and provocative, and we could have easily done 2 to 3 hours here, but these sorts of conversations really drain me after a while, as you might expect. So these chats, to me personally, are best taken in incremental 75 to 90 minute doses. I also felt like I challenged Peter a bit more on his philosophy and worldview than I usually would with guests because of my own interest in occult philosophy, you know, magic and alchemy, and I think that ultimately led to a more interesting conversation and a nice compliment from him at the end there. And that really is what this is all about, sparking thought, sparking new thought, and hoping you guys enjoyed enough that you donate money to me so I can leave my day job behind, which you can do at patreon.com/occulture. And join a growing list of patrons, including Nicholas and Joe and John and Tina, who all hopped on board in the last few days. We're up to 25 patrons on Patreon now, and several more through PayPal. That is quite humbling, and I'm grateful to each of you for finding this worth not only your time, but your money as well. It really does help me grow this show, and hopefully as it continues to grow, we'll be able to produce more content for your ear holes, and maybe your eye holes too, and maybe, just maybe, your in-person holes. Ooh, that would have sounded bad. You guys get my point. Anyway, I'm going to get on out of here before I put my foot further into my mouth hole. So until next time, you've just been initiated into occulture. I am Ryan Peverly reminding you to love yourself, think for yourself, and question authority. Yeah.